thing I want to tell you guys that it's very important that we all work together, whether it's a surgical oncologist, medical oncologist, interventional radiologist, hepatology. The whole point is we all work together, and our whole goal is to give the cancer patient the longest survival, and not just the longest survival, but the best quality of survival. And that's key, because it's not, they did a questionnaire once, and a lot of cancer patients they looked at, and they filled out a questionnaire saying, you know, would if you had cancer, and would you forego a treatment depending on your quality of life? If you had a treatment that would make your quality of life miserable for I don't know how many years, would you do that treatment or would you not do that treatment? Would you just rather not get any treatments if it's going to infect your quality of life? So the whole point is it's a balance. You need to have that good quality of life, and you need to have, obviously, the length of life increased. And our whole goal, whether it's Dr. Volpovich, Dr. Parecki, Dr. Ferraro, is to give the longest life you can with a good quality of life. And that's the balance. And obviously, that's what we all try to do. This is what we all meet together. And our whole goal is to increase your life expectancy, obviously, as long as possible, but also give that quality of life that's so important. So basically, you know, we talked a little about cancer of the livers. You can have a primary cancer of the liver, which means that you just have a new lesion. It's nowhere else in the body. It started in the liver. It may just be staying in the liver. That's called a primary liver cancer. You could have a metastatic cancer, which we talked about today. Colon cancer is the main one. That comes from the colon and goes to the liver. That's spread. That's called metastatic. And then obviously you can have a tumor in the liver that's not cancer. So there's a lot of things you can have. It not necessarily is something in the liver always cancer. And treatments is always based on where the cancer comes from. There's different chemotherapies for different types of cancer. And there's different avenues you can use: chemo, surgery, ablation. I'm going to talk a little about some of the interventional aspects, okay? Basically, if you have underlying liver disease, that may increase the type of cancer you have. Like if you have hepatitis B or C, that may give you more of a risk of getting some types of cancers. And then, you know, so there's different things that affect what kind of cancers you get, okay? So what are some of the treatments? Well, we talked a lot about them, obviously chemo. Transplant, we didn't talk a lot about, I'll just mention in a minute. Surgery, obviously, Dr. Parecki did a great job talking about that. And then there's different things that we haven't talked about yet. Ablation, it's been mentioned a lot, but what is that? What does that mean? Embolization is another one that we use, okay? So primary liver cancers, when we talk about liver transplants, those are usually done with primaries. That means that liver originates in, the cancer originates in the liver, and that can sometimes be cured by taking out a liver and putting a new liver in, or transplant of a liver. And that's when you use transplant. Now, when you have metastatic disease, like colorectal mets, they come from the colon to the liver, those don't work well when you transplant. So a lot of people don't understand that you can't cure every liver by putting another one in. Transplants only work very few times or certain times, and that's important, okay? So again, the gold standard still is surgery, as Dr. Parecki alluded to. So it's something that we have to judge everything in comparison to surgery. So when I do my procedures, like whether it's ablation or chemoembolization or something, a lot of it is matched up to surgery. Is it as good as surgery? Still right now, the gold surgery is still considered surgery. So that's what we have to compare everything to. The problem is when mortality rates can be high with surgery, so not everybody's a surgical candidate. And you know, sometimes you have to do things to make someone a surgical candidate. And some things like ablation or chemoembolization or Y90 embolization can be done to downstage people enough so they can go to surgery. Again, surgeons are extremely important too. As Dr. Parecki said, you may want to ask those surgeons, how many of these cancers have you resected? How many of these procedures have you done? Those are extremely important. How are your results? Don't be afraid to ask a surgeon when you go see them. Ask them how experienced are you in doing this? Just like with an interventional radiologist, if they're going to procedure on you, ask them how many procedures they've done. It's extremely important to know their experience, because the experience level does correlate very well with how well they do. So I'm going to talk a little about minimally invasive procedures today. As opposed to surgery, this is not considered surgery. We're not going to make any big incisions. We're not going to take out anything. Everything is going to be pretty much through a small puncture usually, or a tiny, tiny little incision. Why do we do minimally invasive procedures sometimes? Well, we can be very accurate because we use image guidance. It's faster a lot of times. The safety does increase sometimes because we don't have a lot of the comorbidities that you have with surgery, like the blood loss most of the time. You have a shorter hospital length of stay. Sometimes it's an alternative to some surgeries, and then it's a lot of times better tolerated. Patients can have a better quality of life afterwards. They can bounce back faster. And again, this is very important to say, we're not going to do this if it's going to obviously not be as good as surgery. Like, for instance, you may want to go through a surgery, even though your recovery is longer, if we know your life expectancy is going to go up longer, or your potential for a cure is going to be better. So again, it's a balance between all these. So what is ablation? Everybody talked a lot about it today, and I just want to explain to you what ablation is. There's a lot of different types of ablations. You can freeze something. You can go ahead and put a probe in the liver and cause it to freeze. Basically, we freeze a tumor. The important things to understand with liver tumors is that they die when you freeze them. They die when you heat them. They basically, you can kill them a lot of different ways. You just have to get into the tumor and cause them to die some way or another. Whether you're heating them to a certain point, whether you're freezing them to a certain point, these are all different ways to kill them. So freezing a tumor is cryoablation. A burn is radio frequency ablation, or microwave. Frying is microwave ablation. So just think of it as this. I mean, you're freezing something, you're cooking something, and then there's different ways to embolize something, and we'll talk a little bit about that. But chemoembolization is basically chemotherapy that's directed directly into the liver, or radiation that's directed into the liver, and I'll talk a little bit about that. So what is ablation? Well, basically, this is usually done just laying on the table. We take you into CAT scan or ultrasound. In this case, ultrasound. We'll find the tumor under ultrasound. We'll put a small little probe. It's basically like a biopsy almost. The probe almost looks like a biopsy needle. And we'll put that directly into the tumor under some kind of X-ray guidance, whether it's ultrasound or CT. And we'll either hook it up to some nitrogen or something like that will freeze it, or we'll hook it up to something that will turn on a generator and cook it. But basically, the main thing, obviously, is that we get the whole tumor and that we get a nice surrounding margin of tumor kill, so there's nothing left over. And we can do this for 1, 2, 3, even sometimes 4 metastases. Basically, it is important, though, where these tumors are. Are they close to big blood vessels? Because that could hurt us. Because remember, if we're trying to freeze something and it's close to a big blood vessel, that blood vessel brings a lot of heat to it. Basically, it's continuing to flow. And basically, while you're trying to kill something, and you're getting all this flow next to it that's actually heating it, or even if you're the same thing with heating it, if you're trying to cook it, and that blood now is cooling it. So either way, whether you're cooling that tumor and the blood is getting heat to it, or you're heating that tumor and the blood is cooling it, either way, it's going to hurt you. So we look at, where is it? Is it close to these big blood vessels? Is it close to a structure that we have to be careful with? Is it close, like, for instance, if it's very central, you have biliary ducts there. And if we cook the biliary ducts, which is where all your bile goes, that may cause an obstruction there. And that's a bad thing, because then that's permanent, and it gets very, very difficult. So all these things are very important. Location, area, how big they are. We know the size of them is very important. So all these things we look at when we do these things. So, and there's also some risks to this. Obviously, we talked about, you know, getting close to blood vessels. That's not really a risk. It just hurts us. Now, the nice thing is, even if we cook a blood vessel, it really doesn't matter. It's totally irrelevant. The only thing that it will hurt us is that we won't get the nice outcome, because it's not going to allow us to get rid of the tumor. But again, gallbladder may be a problem. If it's close to colon, we may have to move the colon out of the way. We can do that. We can pump water in to move the colon out of the way, which we typically do. Or we can move different structures out of the way. Or we can move the diaphragm out of the way. But again, these are all different things that we have to look at when we look at positioning of the tumor, okay? So here we go. This is cryoablation. Basically, we put a probe in, we go directly to the tumor, whether we use ultrasound or CT, and basically it's liquid nitrogen, and basically that will actually cool this to a certain temperature. We know if it hits a certain temperature for a certain amount of time, that tissue is dead. That's just the way it is. It's going to die. And then we don't take the tumor out, we leave it in there. Over time, the body will get rid of it. It will just go out through the body, but it takes a long time. It may be there for a long time, but it's dead. It's dead tumor. So basically, that you'll see that tumor on the next CAT scan. But if you did a PET, let's say, the PET would not light up because it's no longer alive. The PET shows that it's no longer alive. So those are all things we look at. So some of the limitations for that, again, you may have a risk of bleeding from it and things like that. There's different risks, like with anything. But, you know, that's something that we have to discuss, and we look at the risk, and we look at, you have to look at, is it worth the risk to do these procedures? And most of the time it is. So RFA is the same thing. It's basically putting a small probe into the liver and basically cooking it. We turn on a generator that causes it to get very, very hot, and basically it cooks the tumor. Same way to do it. It's just like a biopsy needle. It looks kind of like this, radio frequency ablation probe, and it goes this, the tumor would sit right here, and we basically turn on the generator, and it would basically cook the needle. This is FDA approved for liver tumors. It's also FDA approved for a lot of soft tissue tumors around the body. So this is how it looks. Basically, it's a small generator here. We have a small needle into the liver as well, and it causes that heat, and basically that's all there is to it. It's a very small probe, kind of like a biopsy probe. And basically, we make sure, we have to, obviously, this is the key, we have to follow up patients for many years, make sure that it's dead and it doesn't come back, because sometimes it will come back, and that's the key. We need to catch these things early, and this is so important, to follow up. If we don't follow these patients up, I can tell you, in my office, I see a lot of cancer patients, and I can tell you that the whole key of doing any of these procedures is catching them early. You have to catch them early, and the same thing with surgery. So you have to follow these patients up a lot. So you have to maybe go 3 months, 6 months, and a patient who's non-compliant, who doesn't come to the office and get their normal scans, we may follow them. They may come back a year later, and their whole liver is covered with mets. And that didn't have to happen, because if we catch them early enough, they can get different types of chemos, and they can get, and again, all these things that we use, whether it's microwave, RF, or cryo, this can be in conjunction with chemo as well. Chemo does not hurt it in any way, so we can do this in conjunction with chemo. This just shows what it is, what we attach it to. It's basically just, like I said, it's on a probe, it's hooked up to a machine. While we're doing the machine, we monitor the patient very carefully. And here you can see, this is what it is. The patient's laying on a scanner. This is what they have, and they have that in for about 20 minutes. That's in the tumor. It basically cooks the tumor. This is how it looks. This is into the tumor itself. The tumor gets hot. And this is what it is afterwards. This is all there is. It's basically a Band-Aid that we put on. It's a small puncture, and it's basically, it ablates the tumor. You can see here that we know there is a difference between the size of the tumor and recurrence rate. So as this tumor gets bigger, it's harder for us to do that. And so, for instance, a 5-centimeter tumor may be harder to ablate, or will be harder to ablate, and get recurrence rates. You can see here the recurrence of a 2.5-centimeter is very small. Recurrence of a greater than 5-centimeter tumor is very large. So again, it's very important that we catch these things early. And this is why I stress following these patients up, because we want to catch them right when they come out so we can kill them, as opposed to waiting until they get too big. Now let me just change gears a little bit. Chemoembolization, radioembolization. This is the only other two things I want to talk to. This is another minimally invasive procedure. And when I mean minimally invasive, again, we're talking about a puncture in the groin. We're going to take a small needle, we're going to puncture the groin, and all that is going to take place, nothing else. Everything else is done under x-ray. So what it is basically is we're able to thread a small catheter into the liver, into these tumors in the liver, and basically we have two options. One is to use radioactive beads, and what I mean by radioactive beads, they're little beads that are covered with radioactivity. And what we do is, because there's millions of them, we pump those into the tumors that are fed by the blood supply, and basically they become a ball of radiation. Basically these tumors now are just all, get millions of these spheres in, and they just radiate that whole area and basically makes a hole in that area. That's really what it is. It's basically taking radiation therapy through the blood supply of the tumor and causing these tumors to die that way. Another option is to take these little beads and coat them with chemo. So what we do is we soak these beads into chemo, and we actually inject them as well into the tumors. And the difference is now they don't have the radiation that kills them, but they have the chemo and the little spheres. Now, one thing that you have to understand is when we inject spheres into tumors, they do block the blood supply, especially when we do chemo with them. So what happens is we trick these tumors. These tumors are fed. Their lifeline is their blood. Their lifeline is from their hepatic artery, which basically they get all their nutrition, they get all their oxygenation, everything through their blood supply. So whether we inject radiation through their blood supply, so we trick them into killing them by injecting them into their main source of life, or we inject chemo and beads, those both, we trick them into making them, you know, worse off by killing them by either injecting chemo or by radiation and cutting off that blood supply and either radiating them or by soaking them into these very toxic chemotherapeutic drugs. So again, this is obviously not, these are not surgical candidates. These are patients. So RFA ablation or cryoablation is very early on when you have small tumors like I showed, or there's not too many of them. Once they get out of hand And then you have to go to something like this, either pump in chemo with beads or Y90, which is the yttrium, which is the radiation. And again, here's what we do. We basically put these small catheters in. You can see the liver here. We see all this under X-ray, so we can exactly know where we're going. Again, it's minimally invasive. There's no surgery. There's no incisions or anything like that. And you can see here, so we'll go up, we'll thread a catheter. The catheter will go up and into this branch that goes to the liver, and you can see here the liver tumors, and that's where we will inject our little particles. And again, with chemoembo, again, they're soaked in chemo. These beads are soaked in chemo. We inject these chemo beads, and they'll basically soak the tumor cells in chemo. So you're getting a very toxic chemo. You're soaking these tumor cells in that, and you're also cutting off its blood supply because these spheres stay in there forever. So now you have ischemia, which means the tumor can't get any more blood, and they're being soaked in this toxic chemo, and that's what chemoembolization is. So, and radioembolization is something else. Now, I'll talk a little about that too. This is radioembolization and chemoembolization. But again, all these are dependent on the patient. When we talk about, and I don't know if you've ever heard about ECOG status, but how is the patient doing? Is this patient healthy enough to get this procedure? I mean, the type of patient we would most want is someone who you would meet on the street and they wouldn't even know they had cancer. Those patients do the best, and those patients do the best with chemo. Those patients do the best with surgery, and obviously with all our procedures. Although we're maybe able to accept a little more patients than someone with surgery. For instance, if someone that may not have a great mental status and may not be in the greatest shape, we can probably do our procedure more times than someone can that they can get surgery, because surgery obviously takes a little better health sometimes than our procedures do. Again, chemoembolization, basically we do need, after they do have pain. So these tumors do die, but they hurt a lot. And we typically give them a pain pump, and we typically give them antibiotics, and we follow them closely for at least the first few days. Now, brachytherapy is what I was talking about, is Y90, the radiation. These little radioactive beads are pumped into these little tumors, and you can see there's millions of these radioactive beads in the tumors, and they basically just sit there and just radiate the patient. We know from explants that the liver is mostly, almost always spared, and the tumors get this very high dose of radiation. So this is a way almost to do external beam radiation to the liver, but not having to, by using the blood supply of these tumors to cause this radiation kill. And this is how this is done. Basically, the patient, and a lot of times this patient can be totally awake. The patient is laying on a table. We have a small catheter that goes into the groin and into the liver, and that's it. And the patient pretty much is an outpatient procedure. The patient can go home the same day, typically stay 2 to 3 hours. We see them in the office the next week, and they usually do extremely well. They don't really even have any issues, any pain, or anything like that. These are the little spheres. You can see they're tiny. They're about 4 times the size of a red blood cell. So you're talking about a very, very small sphere. And those are the ones that we pump in by millions of them into the tumor. And they just basically engulf the tumor and basically cause this huge ball of radiation. And that's what actually gives you the tumor kill. You can see here, this is one of our patients. You can see these are tumors here in the CT. This is after 3 months. And you can see a lot of times, and not all the time, but many times we'll see these tumors kind of just get kind of melt away over time. And this is one that actually had a virtual complete response. Here's another one, again, big 13 centimeter tumor. This is 3 years post here. We did this one here as well. It's a little different type of tumor, but again, virtually complete response after 3 years. So in summary, the interventional radiologist will bring some additional weapons in the fight against cancer. Again, a lot of the classic weapons, again, are chemo, and those are here to stay, obviously. And a lot of our weapons, and with chemo and surgery, are an adjunct to that. So we use this in conjunction with surgery. We use this in conjunction with chemo, and that's the important thing. Whether we use the radiation beads or whether we use ablation, these patients can continue their chemo, their regular chemo. This is basically to help that work, especially in the liver. Again, team approach is key. We all have to work together. Again, it's all about the patient. We use image-guided ablations, chemoembolizations, radioembolizations. These are all things that we use now. I don't know, in 10 years from now, we may have even additional things that we can use, but these things are very effective if we pick the right patient. And again, patient selection is key, like I said. If we pick the right patient, we can definitely enhance their life, and not only their life expectancy, but also their quality of life, which we think is just as important. Okay, any questions, any comments? Yeah.
So the liver function, what is the chances of having liver problems with yttrium in general?
Mm-hmm. I mean, okay. Yeah, so let's talk about it. So what everybody's really scared about with yttrium, which is the radiation beads, is that you go into radiation liver failure, that the liver starts going to failure from the radiation. That is actually about probably 1 to 2%. We've actually been involved in a trial that was actually, it was a retrospective trial. We had 700 patients. It was called the Moore trial, which we put about, I think, 40 or 50 cases in. I think there were like 7 or 8 centers that put in, we had about 600 or 700 patients. And the actual liver toxicity, where as far as radiation hepatitis, was only about 1 to 2%. So that's number one. Now, as far as ulcers, it has been published now to be in a 1 to 2% probably range at the most, especially with when a site is very experienced at doing this. And I can tell you right now, we've probably done about 1,000 of these in the last 10 years. I would say probably we're up to about 1,000 of them. And obviously, experience has a lot to do with how well you do, or how good, you know, as far as, because ulcers is caused by putting these spheres into GI tract. So if you miss a GI branch, like a gastric branch or a duodenal branch, and or you reflux back into those branches, you'll get an ulcer, a radiation ulcer, because these little radiation beads will get in the stomach, they will get in the duodenum. So it's very important that, you know, you get a site that's very experienced at doing this. But in an experienced site, it's probably in the order of 1%, if that much. So again, cholecystitis, again, 1%. I mean, there's some small, but overall, this has been extremely safe as far as that goes. I mean, we have not had a lot of, you know, we're talking about a few percentage points of each of these, you know. So, and like anything else, I mean, these are risks, even with chemo, with surgery and all this. So, it's one of the things that you have to look at the risk-benefit curves. Does this benefit enough to go through some of these risks? And especially in a patient, we've been doing a lot of salvage patients. And what I mean by salvage is, as Suzanne told you as well, these patients have had all the chemos, they've had everything, and now they basically no longer have anything that will work. They basically can go to best supportive care or hospice, or you know, as long as their liver functions are still okay, they can get this treatment. And there's about 1,000 patients now in the literature showing with these kinds of patients, over 1,000 now. I mean, whether they're either retrospective or they're prospective. But the point is, on almost every study that's ever been written on those patients, there has been a significant increase in survival on those patients on salvage, pretty much across the board. I have not seen, I've pretty much read all the publications that have been written. There hasn't been one publication that hasn't shown a significant increase in survival on those salvage patients. So at least in those, when you don't have, and again, it's all about hope too. I mean, those patients don't have a lot of hope at that point. They don't have a lot of chemo. They don't have a lot of procedures that can help them at that point. So, you know, you're going at what there is available right now. Thank you.